coming up on Need to Know Rochester. Could movies actually help save your marriage? A local professor says yes. He's here to tell us all about a recent study he co-authored to back up that assertion. Also on the show, African-American opera stars have left a rich legacy, but who's following in their footsteps? A young Rochester-area soprano shares more about the somewhat lonely world for young black opera singers and what they're doing to make an impact. And an area hospital celebrates 125 years. We look back at some of its greatest achievements. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know Rochester.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Hello, thanks for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helen B. and Duty Hofer. Apparently, Hollywood can play a pivotal role in helping young marriages avoid separation and divorce. Yes, you heard that correctly, Hollywood. You know, the land the tabloids feed on specifically when it comes to marital breakups. Well, a study at the University of Rochester found that certain Hollywood films can serve as a form of therapy to help married couples work through difficult conversations. So grab your bag of popcorn and a soda, because the study's lead author is here to tell us how it all works. Ronald Rogge, Associate Professor of Psychology at the University of Rochester. It's great to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
So just to start off, I have to have you tell me, how did you ever get the idea to use Hollywood films, considering the seemingly high divorce rate of some of the actors and actresses in these particular movies? Why films in particular for this study?
Well, we wanted to find a way to help couples talk about their relationship. It's kind of a scary thing for a lot of couples to do. It doesn't come very naturally. And so the good thing about movies, even if they have some bad messages, even if the actors don't have perfect relationships themselves, movies have been doing an increasingly better job of showing day-to-day struggles that couples face. And by using the movies, the couples can see somebody else making the same mistakes they may be making. And then suddenly, it's not so threatening to talk about that. I can't tell you how many times I'll be watching TV with my partner or watching a movie with my partner, and a character on screen will do something that I do all the time.
Right.
And being able to see somebody else do it, especially if they do it in a funny way, makes it a lot easier for me to say, you know what? I'm busted.
Right.
I totally do that to you. I'm so sorry. Please understand this is where it's coming from. And suddenly we're having a conversation about it without it being stressful or scary or uncomfortable. And so it just, we figured it was something that could help facilitate.
Well, so with this study, you broke young married couples into three groups, and one being the relationship awareness group focused on film. And then the two other groups, it's important to note, had a strong therapy-led intervention.
Exactly. So we were trying to examine workshops, couples groups, that helped couples strengthen their relationships and prevent divorce. So there are actually four groups. There were three active ones. The two workshop groups, we actually taught the couples skills. We taught them how to communicate better, how to be more supportive toward each other, how to be more forgiving. And then in the movie condition, the relationship awareness condition, we didn't want to teach them anything. We thought, you know, maybe couples already kind of know what they're doing right and what they're doing wrong in the relationship. So maybe we don't need to teach them anything. Maybe they just need to take some time out of their life, prioritize their relationship, and think about how they've been behaving toward each other. And maybe that alone will strengthen their relationship. And so we wanted to have them try to do that with movies. So the couples in the workshop spent about 17 hours in the workshops together. The couples in the movie condition watched about 5 movies and discussed them. So they spent about the same amount of time focused on their relationship, but without us teaching them anything. And then we had another group of couples who didn't get anything. And when we followed them all for 3 years, we were surprised to find.
Tell me, what were you expecting to find?
What we were expecting to find was the workshops where we taught them skills would have the lowest rates of divorce. And in fact, compared to the 24% divorce in the couples who got no treatment, the couples in the workshop groups had only about 11 to 12% divorce. So we cut it in half, wow, which was fantastic. We figured that the couples watching the movies and discussing them would have maybe slight benefits from that, but we never expected that they would have as low divorce rate as the couples in the workshops, and that's exactly what we found.
How surprised were you?
We were incredibly surprised, and it's really such a cool finding because it means we don't really need to come at couples and say, you need to do this a different way. We need to teach you how to do this. It's a really empowering message. It means no. A lot of couples already know how to have a successful relationship. They maybe just need to put a little more time and effort into trying to do that, trying to be the best partner they can be for each other.
Let's take a look at, we put a little montage of some of the clips that were used in this study so some of our viewers can check them out. So let's take a look at a few of these clips.
You make me want to be a better man.
John Wade Prentice. Isn't that a lovely name?
John Wade.
Joanna Prentice, I'll be.
We put up a big glass wall to keep from getting hurt, but it also keeps you from getting touched. It's a risk, isn't it, Jenny?
You got with me in spite of your family, because you were curious about black.
Is that what you think it was?
Yeah, I do.
Let me ask you, to what extent did the discussion of the movies factor into the positive outcome versus the content of the movies themselves?
Well, we're studying that right now in a follow-up study, but we really think it's the discussions that were the most important part. We think that we encouraged the couples, after they watched each of the movies they chose from the list, to sit down and talk about how the couple on screen handled different areas in their relationship, how they handled conflict, how they supported each other as friends. And then we had them talk about how, as a couple, they were similar or different to the couple on screen. And we think it was talking about that, thinking about that, focusing on those areas of their relationship in a meaningful way that really helped those couples give them sort of just the shot in the arm they needed to be better for each other and have happier relationships as a result.
We saw in the clip, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. Now, my parents love that movie. They were in a biracial, interracial marriage, I should say, and I can remember when I was young, they were sitting me down, put in the VHS tape and said, watch this. This is what we went through. And so they were able to cling to that and to learn from that couple in the film. Is there a chance, though, that, let's say, a couple on film have a disturbing relationship and could have the opposite effect, so to speak? Like, what do you think about that?
Well, it potentially could, although I think that a couple can probably take advantage of just about any movie. We encouraged the couples to pick the movies they thought they would enjoy the most. We wanted this to be a pleasant experience. And even if the couple on screen is dealing with issues in a really damaging way, the couple watching it might take from that, you know, obviously we're not being that horrific to each other, but maybe there are some times that I am kind of attacking when we talk about something. And maybe we don't want to turn into that couple on screen. What can we do to avoid being them? So even seeing bad behavior on screen can help the couples recognize maybe the seeds of that bad behavior in their own relationship and try harder not to be that kind of partner.
So how did you come up with this specific list of movies? Because I told my editor about this and he said, what types of films? I mean, Sleepless in Seattle, you know, and Harry Met Sally.
Right.
People might think of some of these really romantic, gushy films. How did you come up with this list?
Okay, so we had one criterion that unfortunately kept Sleepless in Seattle and When Harry Met Sally off the list.
Okay.
Those are wonderful films, right. Don't get me wrong. But for the film to be on the list and for the film to be helpful for this process, the couple has to, on screen, has to be in a relationship, not falling in love. So they need to show a long-term couple and the day-to-day dynamics of being in a long-term relationship. That's our only criteria. So movies like When Harry Met Sally or Sleepless in Seattle don't work as well because you don't see the couple together into the final frames of the movie. So it wouldn't give the couple could watch that movie together, but it wouldn't give them as much to talk about because they wouldn't see those couples handling conflict necessarily. So, but that still gave us a wide range of movies to choose from. So, and including romantic comedies like Couples Retreat and Four Christmases, which are fun films and still portray a bunch of really realistic dynamics that couples struggle with.
I'm sure that there are some viewers watching right now and they are possibly very skeptical. And they may say, how in the world can movies serve such a purpose? We're taught in our society, if there's an issue in a marriage, you go see a therapist. You have a middleman, that voice of reason to help you, you know, to take care of the issue. What would you say to the skeptics?
Well, first I would like to make the point that if couples are really, really unhappy, if their relationship has really grown very troubled and they're on the brink of divorce, then probably seeing a therapist is not a bad idea. We're not trying to replace couples therapy. What this is trying to do is to catch couples much, much earlier while they're still happy with each other, but things might be starting just to go south. But what I would say to the skeptics is give it a try. I mean, the worst you're gonna lose is an evening watching a movie with your partner and then spending 15 or 20 minutes discussing it. We're doing a follow-up study, and couples have given us feedback that they really have enjoyed the process.
Well, Ronald Rogge, Associate Professor of Psychology at the University of Rochester, it's great to have you here, thank you so much. And if you are interested in learning more about the study and getting your hands on that movie list, go to couples-research.com. And from the movies to the opera, for young African-American opera singers trying to make a name for themselves, the opera world can be a lonely place. While a rich legacy has been left by the likes of Marian Anderson and Jesse Norman, among others, even in 2014, minority faces in this genre of music seem to be lacking. To examine this issue more, I'm joined by local soprano Brittany Walker. And Brittany, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
So, as I mentioned, you know, African-American opera, it does have a rich history. And that includes the many struggles for black opera performers to make it into this mainstream realm of music. Mm-hmm. And, you know, however, when I look at young performers in this particular field, I just don't hear much about them. I did my research when I learned about you, and it was hard to find information about them. And I wanted to get your take and your perspective on this as a young black opera singer.
Well, certainly there are many of the older generation that people are used to hearing about, like Leontine Price and Jesse Norman, and even Grace Bumbries, and all of the other wonderful, glorious black opera singers, William Warfield, who was actually from Rochester himself. But there is a gap in the generations as far as us being out there, partially because there are very few of us, I think, in the grand perspective of things. But we are out there. And myself being one of them, I know many, many wonderful younger generation black opera singers that I just was blessed and privileged to share the stage with in Syracuse Opera, actually. So I know they're out there, but
you're small in number, and is it just that, or is it perhaps that the mainstream media doesn't showcase your work as much, or perhaps they're not showcasing the work of classical singers in general?
I think it's a bit of both.
Okay.
I think as a minority, you always find us in lesser quantities, and especially because our music is typically not, you know, opera. It's very kind of, I guess, just different to find a black opera singer, because we're typically, stereotypically looked at as the pop, the R&B, the soul singer, because that's our roots. I mean, very, very well, you know, is a very good reason why. However, I do know that
You're saying this kind of these are your roots, but
yeah.
So people may not expect to see
yeah.
you and to hear from you.
Yeah, and classical music itself is being less and less spoken of, and just less and less, you know, heard about, read about, attended even the performances. It's just there's controversy that opera is a dying art.
I want to ask you about that too.
Yeah.
Well, first tell me how you got into opera. I mean, what was it about this genre of music that just really called to you to pursue a career in this?
Well, actually, I was almost one of those who was stuck in the stereotypical black image of pop, of jazz, of R&B, of soul, but a wonderful high school music teacher heard me sing all those wonderful genres and said, I bet you could do more. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Alan Jones was the one who gave me a classical solo to sing when I was a sophomore in high school. And from then on, I went to a competition with it and never looked back. So I got 100
that
classical solo, and then I went on to audition for major schools for opera and ended up getting into Eastman, Roberts, Nazareth, and all of them. And I said, this is what I want to do, and just like that, a happenstance, somebody believing in me.
I want our viewers to get a chance to hear you sing, and we have a clip
okay.
of you singing Summertime. Set up this clip for us. Tell us what they're about to see.
You are about to see a performance of mine as concerto aria winner at Roberts Wesleyan, my alma mater. It's the performance that I gave as the winner
okay.
of that competition in 2012.
Very good. Let's check it out. So no doubt a beautiful voice you have. And I want to talk to you. I've seen Gershwin's Porgy and Bess on Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
It's been called the first great American opera, a first to highlight the lives of black Americans.
Mm-hmm.
You actually, as you mentioned, debuted in Syracuse in Porgy and Bess, the role of Clara.
Yes.
And when it comes to going beyond Porgy and Bess and Aida, for example, these are operas that traditionally have black roles
mm-hmm.
cast. There are not a plethora of roles available for young black opera performers, so it would seem. And it seems that there's a typecast issue. You said
mm-hmm.
we get stereotyped. You know, just now, Broadway, the Phantom of the Opera is getting its first black lead just now
mm-hmm.
On Broadway. So, you know, how does that influence or impact you and your role and what you want to do with this role?
Well, I think I just look beyond the stereotypes. I mean, although Aida and Clara and Bess, and they are all, you know, typically played by black sopranos and black artists. However, you know, it's just a fight within myself that I push on to say, I'm going to play these other roles, these Mozarts and these Rossinis and these other roles that, you know, that are not the typical for me, but don't have a stamp of this is only for a Caucasian European performer. You know, we just have to push past the stereotype and sing with quality, sing the music as it was meant to be sung, as the composer intended, but just break out of the stereotypes for ourselves.
What's a role you dream of playing?
Oh my goodness. Whew. so many. Besides Aida, that is a very difficult question.
Many. And would you ever consider wearing multiple hats and perhaps even writing an opera?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
I've thought about it many times. And it probably would be scripted around the scriptures, a Bible opera, something, you know, from that from that sort of
that genre. Mm-hmm. Well, many things to look forward to with you in your future. Mm-hmm. We wish you the best. Soprano Brittany Walker, thank you for your time
thank
and for
you
your
so
insight
much.
Today. And you can learn more about Brittany and her upcoming performances. Check out our website, BrittanyWalkerSoprano.com. Years, that's how long Highland Hospital's doors have been open in our community. And during that time, the hospital has led the medical community in a number of firsts. It had the first family medical program in New York State, and it was the first hospital to allow fathers in the delivery room. To learn more about this landmark anniversary, I'm joined by Highland Hospital's Dr. Roger Ostfig, and it's great to have you here.
Thank you. I am glad to be here.
Thank you.
So Happy birthday. Happy quasquincentennial.
Exactly.
Five-quarter birthday.
So speaking of that, I mean, Highland Hospital opened its doors in 1889, the first homeopathic hospital and one of the first in the U.S. To begin, in general, how does a hospital last for 125 years?
Because it has good principles that are based upon advancing the health of individuals. Committed boards, committed volunteers, committed benefactors.
Well, I want, as I mentioned, you know, previously, Highland is definitely a hospital of firsts. It was the first to open a chemical laboratory on site in 1917, also the first to promote the idea of shared medical records. Tell me about the significance of leading some of these trends.
Okay, it began with nine physicians who were not certain that the Monroe County Homeopathic Society was doing principled medicine in the way that Samuel Christian Hahnemann had designed that particular thought of medicine. So they decided to form their own hospital. And they came together and incorporated on April 4th, and on Hahnemann's birthday, April 10th, 1889, opened the hospital adjacent to a park that Ellwanger and Berry had donated to the city to be designed by Frederick Law Olmsted as one of the city's park system to look over the city. Advanced at the time to give patients care best possible with no reference to whether they could pay. Before the hospital opens, it establishes a board of lady managers that become the force behind the hospital throughout its existence.
Well, I want to know what you think the influence of some of these firsts have played on the longevity of Highland.
Okay, the hospital recruits a physician named John R. Williams in the mid-19-teens, and he makes a case that a third of the patients dying in Rochester every year are dying of common diseases, and therefore we ought to establish a clinical laboratory to study germs and the chemistry of body fluids and the causes of pathology, and therefore we will be able to make a difference in people's health. They recruit a scientist, a woman named Dr. Humphrey, who establishes the first relationship between high blood sugar and kidney disease, goes on to have a very important role in the state health department in advancing that disease. This laboratory becomes a basis so that in 1922, when a kid, John Havens, with diabetes, is dying of his diabetes, John Williams is able to make a case for Banting in Toronto to smuggle insulin to Rochester, and the first person treated in the United States with insulin for diabetes was done in Rochester.
And speaking of that gentleman, Havens, he was 20 years old at the time. He lived to the age of 60 and went on to be an artist. And I want to know, what was that, a rarity? I mean, considering it was 20 years old when he was insulin was first administered to him and lives to be 60.
Yes.
For that time.
Very rare. It was estimated that he had had nearly 50,000 insulin injections by the time of his death. You're right. He was a very famous and respected artist, particularly in woodcuts.
And tell me, what firsts have been new to Highland in the last 5 to 10 years?
You mentioned the family medicine program, first in New York State, third in the country. We have a highly renowned nationally bariatric surgery program. It's the first geriatric orthopedic co-management program that's now been replicated more than 100 times around the world because of its advancement in that. We had the first comprehensive breast center. The nursing program at Highland is a magnet. It has Joint Commission Excellence Awards in a number of centers, in addition to robotic surgery and things like that.
Is it difficult? I mean, how does the hospital continue to adapt to the emerging needs of the medical community?
Well, I think what you have to say is the hospital's administration is nimble and insightful enough that what it does is remove the barriers for innovation to do something better.
125 years down, any other firsts that you could believe or you hope are on the horizon for Highland 100 years plus down the road?
I think what its history says is I hope we can't guess. Who would have imagined that taking ox pancreas would be a treatment for diabetes? Who would have imagined that we could cut the mortality rate from hip fractures in geriatric patients 50% by having a co-management program? Who would have imagined that? I hope we can't imagine what's going to happen going forward.
Well, Dr. Roger Ospig of Highland Hospital, happy birthday to you, to the hospital, and I thank you so much for being here, and thank you for your time. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helen B. and Duty Hofer. Thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI. We will see you next Thursday night at 8 right here on WXXI TV.